Most gracious God of all wisdom and truth, as we honor these seniors, we would also ask for them an awareness of the privilege of having been a part of the Punahou experience, within which they have made a fair beginning in the use of their minds to know what is true, their senses to delight in what is beautiful, and their wills to love what is good. They have been given opportunities to wrestle with ideas from philosophers of ancient Greece to Martin Luther King Jr. and Andrei Sakharov. They have marveled at matter through microscopes. They have winged their way back millions of years to the very origins of human life. Some of them have fallen in love with beauty. Leonardo da Vinci and Michelangelo, the pyramids of Egypt and the Eiffel Tower, Yoda and children of a lesser god. And they have been continually challenged to ask what is truly good and worthy on Capitol Hill and Wall Street, in nuclear weapons and South African apartheid, in Mikhail Gorbachev's perestroika and George Bush's 1,000 points of light. We pray that these seniors are persuaded that while lifetime is involved in an education, they know enough now of what is true and beautiful and good to hold to certain convictions that wealth, no matter how hard earned, is a gift to them from you, a gift to be shared to lift the less gifted from the grime and grit of life, to assuage their hunger for bread or justice, for peace or freedom, for knowledge or understanding. That power is a possession plagued with peril, but potent with promise. Not because it satisfies a lust for controlling others, but because it lets them minister to others and to imitate your ways of love and self-giving. And that reputation and fame are not to be pursued as ends in themselves, but as vehicles to allow others to know them, to know what they are really like, and thus to aspire to a comparable generosity and graciousness. As we look ahead to what lies ahead for these seniors, we pray that they may be inspired and energized by the same concern for others as the Academy's program of community service. May they realize that caring for others is a rewarding experience, and that as they reach out to others, then their wealth and power and fame will help them to better know themselves. And may they know that it's worth getting to know themselves, because after all, they are going to have to live with you and others and themselves forever. Amen.
What we're trying to say is that after years and years of zits and sweat, laughter and side pains, studying and procrastination, after making so many friends who will hopefully last us the rest of our lives. We're beginning to realize that.
We are out of here!
Boy, it sure was rough and tough. Papers and grades we have no more. Now it's time for fun galore. Graduation is here at last. We'll forget about the past. Now is the time to get rowdy. Time to live it up and party!
Welcome and to thank the many people responsible for this celebration of commencement, of ending, and of beginning. We feel that the Punahou graduation is special and unique. The seniors, in large part, graduate themselves with their own speeches and with the songs that they compose and sing. It's in keeping with our philosophy that students who have learned to take responsibility for their own learning should take responsibility for their graduation. I will attempt this evening both the obvious and the impossible. First, I will certify and verify to Dr. McPhee that these young men and women are indeed ready to receive their diplomas and leave us. That is the obvious. Each year, since before these seniors were born, I have chosen an adjective to characterize the graduating class, a task which is clearly futile, and this is the impossible. Perhaps only my IWL students will comprehend this absurd gesture. Although I recognize that no adjective can adequately describe so many individuals, I hope that you seniors will accept the adjective because it is unique, just as your class and your process of graduating is unique. Several students have spoken this evening and last Sunday at baccalaureate of fond memories at Punahou, of little things which come to mean so much. The special plot for variety show, the embarrassing sophomore luau talent, senior slump, and the upper class mango slingers. And then, since most of you entered Punahou in early years, there are fond memories of the junior school. Juice time and kissing girls, nap time and denim mats, Camp Timberline and Land of Nar jokes, the banyan tree. I'd like to take this opportunity to allow the seniors, many of whom entered Punahou in early grades, to express their thanks to all the junior school teachers for all the junior school experiences. And I call on my friend and colleague, the principal of the junior school, Mr. Duane Yee, to rise and be acknowledged. As I said earlier, my role is to verify your qualifications for graduation. Remember, as I recount your record, that your class represents only 405 of the 10,000 seniors graduating from Hawaii high schools this year. You've won a disproportionately large share of the laurels and awards which have been given in this state. For example, the National Merit Scholarship Corporation each year tests and identifies a select group of high school students whom they call National Merit Semifinalists. This year, 71 out of 10,000 in Hawaii earned this honor, and 20 or 28% of these top scholars are in your class. Across the nation, 1,800 seniors won National Merit $2,000 scholarships. Based upon its total number of high school seniors, Hawaii had 8 winners. 2 of these, Priscilla Twan and Valerie Chalk, sit before you tonight. This year, students from Punahou took 499 advanced placement examinations, which have the potential to earn college credit or placement or both, and which are a good indicator of the quality and quantity of advanced work being done by students in a senior class. I'm confident that this record is unsurpassed by any other school in Hawaii. There are from 6 to 10 schools competing in 12 Interscholastic League of Honolulu varsity Division I sports. Under the leadership of seniors, our teams won 8 of the 12 possible ILH championships in the women's division and 9 of the 16 possible championships in the men's division. In many sports, the ILH is known to be the toughest league in the state, and yet you men and women of the class of 1990 led our teams to 60% of the possible league championships, which is truly an amazing record. Again, recalling that your numbers are relatively small, let's take a look at the state championships. In order to even compete at the state level, you student athletes had to be winners in the rugged Interscholastic League. The men led 6 and the women led 3 winning teams for a total of 9 out of 20 possible state championships. For one senior class with only 4% of the state student population to win almost 50% of the championships is incredible. And it's probably a record that's unmatched by any other high school in the United States. The spirit evident in academics and athletics held true in other school activities as well. For the past 4 years, members of your class have served as the backbone of our technical crew for theatrical productions. 40 of you have received special recognition for works of art, either displayed or published. Most distinguished among the distinguished is your classmate Janet Allard, who twice won the National Young Playwrights Award. Sometimes, in spite of records such as yours, others are tempted to judge by appearances. And sometimes teenagers appear self-centered and self-concerned. In reality, I think what denotes your class more truly was seen last fall upon the death of both the junior school's Bill Knowlton and your classmate Karen's father, Bill Buck, who had been an academy mathematics teacher. You came together in grief and demonstrated your caring, and we were all the better for it. I think that you will be remembered more for what you have given than for the facts and the education you have merely received. I think of your record-breaking, award-winning donations of blood this spring. I think of your leadership and support for Amnesty International, the thousands of letters you've written. And I think especially of the seemingly small but really profound model that, as Jennifer Levinson noted so beautifully, that some of you have provided for ecological concerns, for recycling, for the ethic of thinking globally and acting locally. You've given many faculty and administrators a new perspective on ecology, and what greater gift could you give? So what's the adjective going to be? Your deans wanted an S word, a word that would suggest senior, successful, serving, and special. I needed a word which would make you feel unique, an individual, yet nevertheless a member of a community. I wanted a word which would denote your uniqueness. And I think a major aspect of your uniqueness lies in the fact that you have served rather than having been waited upon. The word I've selected is eleemosynary. It's a word that will at once be easy for you to remember and unique, and I hope easy for you to spell. Eleemosynary relates to charity, which in turn has connotations of generosity, benevolence, and helpfulness, especially toward those less fortunate. It's a word which links you to our distant past, to the missionaries who founded Punahou. This year, you initiated a program of community service started by Mr. Casey, Mr. Metzger, Mr. Berry, and Mr. Bowen, who is also the father of your classmate, Amy. You became, through no choice of your own, the first class in modern history in which every senior completed a 40-hour unit of community service. But what started as a requirement, many of you made into a wonderful choice. We listened in those special chapels at the end of the year as you spoke about your community service experiences. And we realized that by your acceptance and your choice, you had taken this experience beyond a requirement and into the realm of personal values. Yesterday, after exams were over and all the grades were in, I watched two of you seniors patiently lugging recycling boxes, as you've done all year, and I reflected on how this simple act was symbolic of the fact that many of your classmates have continued your community service even after the requirement was over. In the fall of 1988, Trustee David Fairbanks challenged our faculty to extend beyond our physical boundaries rather than to withdraw, become smug, superior, or self-satisfied. These remarks were quoted by Mr. Doug Bennett, also a parent of a senior, Paul. In his wonderful baccalaureate address, Mr. Bennett offered you a license to care. His message comes from his experience, but many of you have also learned that helping others helps yourself. The feeling of being valuable and the feeling of having purpose and meaning is essential to your own mental health. I hope that at least one remark from Mr. Bennett will echo in your hearts and minds forever. He offered each of you the joy and benefit of reaching out to others, and he reminded you that the choice of caring is entirely yours. Then he said, "If you think you can't, you're right. If you think you can, you're right. Just ask Charlie Wiedemeyer." Our last mahalogram to you is this. Thank you for your attitude towards service to others. Thank you for reawakening the tradition of helpfulness and community service, which motivated the missionaries who founded this school almost 150 years ago. Future classes will build upon the base you've constructed, for this is the way that positive traditions are created. Dr. McPhee, on behalf of the faculty, with pride and yet with some sadness at parting, I present for their diplomas the Ely Mossenary class of 1990.
I love you!